Beloved community, come let us bless God's holy name together, for God's steadfast love is the breath of life. Whether you are part of First Church, an inclusive and justice-seeking church in the heart of our nation's capital, or whether you are a guest or friend joining us from many different locations, we welcome you to worship on this third Sunday in Lent as we continue our theme, the breath of life. In this hour of worship, we beseech God to lead us from death to life, from falsehood to truth, from despair to hope, from fear to trust, from hate to love, from war to peace. However you show up this morning, may you breathe in the breath of life, which is God's gift of grace. This morning we are thrilled to welcome a new member into our midst, Amanda Rojana. Her bio is in our worship folder, so please do take the time to read it and get to know a little more about her. As a reminder to those here in the sanctuary, please do remain masked, observe distancing, and we invite you to hum rather than sing the opening hymn. Almost every week, we are reviving our common life together in a new way. Today, we will sing the closing hymn congregationally. Friends, I want to remind you, it is once again time to order your Easter flowers using the insert found in the worship folder. You can complete this and leave it in the offering plate on your way out. If you're joining us virtually, please click on the link in your worship folder and use our digital order form. Today, Reverend Sam is on site at People's Congregational UCC as he leads an outdoor worship experience for children and youth with our sibling congregation. He will be back next week and convening Sunday school for children ages 5 and up. Following worship today, please join us for an important congregational conversation as we report on our year-long racial justice audit. All are welcome. Friends, no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome into the shared experience of worshiping the God whose love knows no bounds. Let us worship together, beginning with our opening hymn, God Who Called Us Through the Prophets, stanzas 1-4. Please rise in body or in spirit.
Thank you. Good morning, friends. It's good to see you all. Early on in the pandemic, it's hard to believe it was 2 years ago this time. I noticed a car with a bumper sticker parked in the lot outside my apartment building. It featured the image of the serpent we often see on those now all too familiar "Don't tread on me" flags, but it read instead, "Don't breathe on me." At the time, there was, and there still is, really, much fear and confusion and uncertainty around the reality of the COVID-19 virus and what the pandemic means for our lives. So I confess a part of me kind of appreciated the wry humor. But as I have thought more about it, I still see it now every now and then, that bumper sticker. It makes me sad. It reminds me of all the ways in which we, in our limited imaginations and our misguided drive for self-preservation, try to apportion the common good and the vast gift of God's creation according to our own personal measurements. This is my error, this is your error. I will live in the safety and certainty of my world, and you can live in the safety and certainty of yours. The false addiction that we can be our own islands. But creation reminds us that this is false and ultimately death-dealing way of living. Until we fully recognize that we are inextricably connected, that what one part of the body experiences impacts the whole body, our efforts and our actions to seal ourselves away from our neighbors, the pain of our neighbors, the pain of the world, and the pain of ourselves ultimately fall short and fail us. There once was a rabbi who was asked by his students, "Master, how should one determine the hour in which night ends and the day begins?" One student suggested, "Is it when a person can distinguish a sheep from a dog in the distance?" "No," said the rabbi, "it is not." A second student ventured, "Is it when one can determine whether or not distinguish between a fig tree and a date tree from afar?" "It is not that either," replied the rabbi. Please tell us the answer," the students begged. "How should one determine when the night has ended and the day has begun?" The rabbi responded, "It is when you look in the face of a neighbor, a stranger, and you see your sister and brother. Because until then, the night is still with us." Let us pray together silently. The breath of life has the power to quiet the mind, calm the body, and reconnect us to the present and to each other. Take a moment to reconnect with your breath, perhaps deepening your inhale or lengthening your exhale. Maybe there is a sacred word that arises in your spirit when you repeat with the breath, such as grace or hope. Or a connection. Let us enter into a moment of sacred silence as we return to the breath. And now, as we extinguish the light, we acknowledge the breath snuffed out by the shadows of addiction and despair. Let us pray. Loving God, as we breathe through this holy season of Lent, meet us here in heartache and hope, in fear and joy, in clenched fists and cupped hands. Fill our lungs with breath and our lives with meaning. Amen.
I would now like to welcome forward Amanda, as well as Andrew and Freda, who will help with our new member welcome. Amanda, feel free to stand right here. Actually, let's scoot over a little bit. Great. Friends, this morning we joyfully receive Amanda Rojana into the life of First Church as she claims this community as her spiritual home. A few highlights from her bio. Amanda is married to Dan. They've been married for 23 years. She has two children who are the love of her life. She serves as an ASL interpreter with a government agency, and she loves Virginia trees. Amanda, we're so grateful to have you in our midst this morning. So I have a few questions for you. Amanda, do you promise to journey faithfully with this community of faith, bringing your unique history, traditions, stories, and gifts to enrich our life together If so, please answer, I do with the help of God.
There's an outreach membership first.
Andrew.
Sorry. So let us welcome Amanda with the First Church Covenant.
Oh, no, no. Yes. There's another question. I'll go ahead and ask it. Yes. It's okay. Amanda, do you promise to worship with us regularly, opening your heart to the presence of the still speaking God among us? If so, please answer, I do with the help of God.
Do you promise to enlist in the work of First Congregational United Church of Christ as it serves this community and the world? If so, please answer, I do, with the help of God.
Sorry, now this question. Let us welcome Amanda with the covenant of this congregation. In grateful response to the call of Jesus Christ,
we covenant with God and with each other to be a church of Christ. We bind ourselves in God's redeeming presence to walk together in ways revealed to us by the Holy Spirit, in sacrament and word, study and prayer, fellowship and mission. Let us pray. Loving God, we welcome with joy this new member into the full life of First Congregational United Church of Christ. By the power of your Holy Spirit, may we continue to grow in love, seek justice, and live out the radical hospitality of Christ together. Amen.
Amen.
And now we will enjoy a musical response. Amanda, a mug, as well as a really great book about our 150th anniversary, which includes everything you ever wanted to know about the church. So as we give that to Amanda and welcome her, I invite all of us to pass the peace of Christ with one another with words such as, peace be with you. And I also invite folks to unmute.
Peace be with you. Good morning,
peace
everybody. Good morning.
Welcome, Amanda.
Peace be with you, everybody.
Good morning. Peace be with you.
Peace,
Peter.
Peace be with you. Good morning,
Peter.
Happy springtime.
Oh, another Peter.
Good morning,
Peter Burns.
Good morning. Peace be with you.
Bushmiller Anderson, peace be with you.
Good morning.
Olson family, peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
Good morning. Good morning, Susan. Good morning. How are you?
Good morning, Alex. Peace be with you.
Good morning.
Olson. Morning, Mary Catherine. Peace be with
good morning.
You. And Jody.
Me in the same group.
Robert, I'm loving your background.
Good morning. Hey, Lindsay. How you doing?
Morning, Lindsay. Peace be with you.
Good morning.
Oh, Robert, you're like in a fun that. Place. Peace be with you.
That looks nice. Looks very nice.
Peace, Carol and Cynthia McGarrity's.
Hi, peace, Anne.
Good morning.
Grace, peace be with
Cynthia,
you.
Cynthia, peace.
Jason,
Peace. Good morning.
Peace, Susan.
Peace, everyone.
Okay, friends, I invite us to find our seats and quiet our hearts as we prepare to hear a word of scripture read for us this morning by Lindsay Swisher on Zoom.
Morning, First Church. The first scripture reading this morning is Psalm 96, verses 1 through 13. Sing to the exalted a new song. Sing to the Creator, all the earth. Sing to the Most High, bless her name. Proclaim from day to day her salvation. Declare among the nations her glory, among all the peoples her marvelous works. For great is the ageless God, and greatly to be praised. Revered is she above all gods. For all the gods of the peoples are idols, yet the womb of life made the heavens. Splendor and majesty are before her. Strength and beauty are in her sanctuary. Give to the majestic one, you families of the peoples. Give to the mighty one glory and strength. Give to the fire of Sinai the glory due her name. Bring an offering and come into her courts. Bow down and worship the sovereign one in majestic holiness. Tremble in her presence, all the earth. Say among the nations, the ever-living God reigns. Indeed, the world is firmly established. It shall never be moved. God will judge the peoples with equity. Let the heavens rejoice and the earth be glad. Let the sea roar along with what fills it. Let the field exult and all that is in it. Then shall all the trees of the forest sing for joy before the wisdom of the ages, for she is coming, to judge the earth. She will judge the world with righteousness and the peoples with her truth.
From Paul's letter to the new church in Rome, probably the last of his letters and the most theologically complex. What then shall we say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? God is the one who did not spare the very child of God, but rather for all of us, handed the Messiah over. Will not God, with Christ, also give us everything else? Who then will bring any charge against the elect of God? God is the one who justifies. Who will condemn? It is Christ Jesus, the one who died, moreover, the one who was raised and who is at the right hand of God, who intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will affliction, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are completely victorious through the one who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor powers that be, nor things that are, nor things that will be, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Redeemer. Here ends the lesson.
Will you pray with me? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, O God. For you are our rock and our Redeemer. Amen.
Juan de Yepes y Alvarez was born in Avila, Spain in 1542. His father came from a wealthy family who disowned him when he married a woman of lower class status. Juan's family knew the indignities of poverty. His father died when he was just 3 years old and his brother 2 years later, likely due to malnutrition. Juan was sent to a boarding school for poor children where he received a religious education. He came of age working in a hospital, then made vows to join the Carmelites, a religious order founded on the ideals of a simple life spent in solitude and prayer. He studied theology at the University in Salamanca, became an expert in biblical studies, and controversially translated Song of Songs into Spanish. In 1567, he was ordained a priest and met Teresa of Avila, a charismatic nun. The two conspired to reform their Carmelite order, deepening vows of simplicity and contemplative faith as they called out the corruptions of the wider church. As a result, Juan, now known as Friar Juan de la Cruz, was kidnapped by local church authorities and imprisoned for 9 months in a windowless cell, so small he could barely stand. The stone cell was frigid in the winter, suffocating in the summer. Once again, he was malnourished. High in the wall of his cell, however, was a 3-inch hole. And by the light of that hole, with paper smuggled to him by a guard, Juan wrote poems such as Noche Oscura del Alma, which would nourish souls for centuries to come. He also worked the hinges off his cell door to escape. Juan spent 8 months recuperating and writing commentaries on his poetry, which detailed the contemplative life of a mystic. You may know him as Saint John of the Cross, originator of the concept, the dark night of the soul. Over the course of our lives, most of us will experience a season akin to the dark night of the soul, a spiritual desolation in which the architecture of belief collapses, rendering life meaningless. It is often experienced as an absolute separation from God, a wilderness where the religious practices that once kindled the warmth of spiritual intimacy grow cold. It is a time marked by spiritual restlessness, for the former ways of knowing God have been obliterated. One is left fumbling in the dark. I want to clarify at the outset that a dark night of the soul is not equivalent to depression. If you have a diagnosis, a history of depression in your family, if you are experiencing signs of depression or anxiety, it is always advisable to connect with your therapist or doctor. Medication can be life-saving. I'm happy to talk personally with anyone who might wonder if they are experiencing depression, a dark night of the soul, or both. In this community, we can talk about hard things. Now, imagine with me for a moment the heavy blanket of night, void of light, no moon or stars, no street lights or cell phones to guide your way. Now add to that the sensation of being lost, not just directionally, but spatially, not sure what's up or down, which way is further into the thickening forest or a way out. Silence entombs your ears. Are you terrified? Anxious? Immobilized? Do you thrust yourself forward or collapse and weep, waiting for rescue? What if you don't know when the dawn will come, if ever? These are the sensations of spiritual desolation. Maps have broken down, former pathways are inaccessible. You feel utterly alone, witness to a kind of death.
You are disoriented and in despair. The cathedral of your most deeply held beliefs, your conceptions of the world and God, have disintegrated. Have you ever been through a dark night of the soul? The loss of a loved one can bring it on. Pandemic isolation can bring it on, and utter failure of institutions in which we used to trust, a disillusionment with society, the horrors of war, a violent encounter or traumatic disaster. No one enters willingly into this dark night, but it finds most of us at some point. Sometimes we blame ourselves, wondering if we've lost our faith. Other times we pray to God that this cup might pass, that the thorn in the side would be removed. Perhaps like Jesus, we beckon our friends to stay awake to our suffering, only to find the flesh indeed is weak. We have not cultivated a society in which people learn to be present to the suffering of others. If you lashed out at God, you'd be in good company. I remember the fall of 1998 when my faith fell apart on the back roads of Honduras, visiting banana plantations, maquiladoras, and impoverished rural communities. Indigenous families whose ancestral lands were being stolen right out from under them by developers hungry for beachside property. I remember a community that lived atop an uncapped landfill, and garbage would come up from the ground when it rained. I remember taking all of this in and feeling like someone had lied to me for emitting so much. I learned the history of the U.S. interference in Honduras, leading to international corporations gobbling up arable land, and the installation of authoritarian governments. Gone were the foolish fables I had entertained about our nation as a child. It was a coming of age. And just as I was ingesting it all, trying to make sense of it, seeing if these dry bones could hold together a withering faith, Hurricane Mitch hit, and it knocked the breath from me. To witness such aching desolation and utter loss, to see communities accustomed to rebuilding and rebuilding yet never gaining ground, it was as if God had insulted all of us. I lashed out in anger and bewilderment. Where are you, God? Is this a game to you? The traditions of my youth held no comfort. The words of Scripture were like eating ash, as my understanding of God broke like the bow of a fiddle trying to make music across the fresh wounds of my soul. There comes a point when the well of tears runs dry. There comes a point of relaxing into the cocoon of separation that prevents us from seeing God. A time when we begin to ask, what will help us last the endless night? The question arises in the words of Valerie Kaur, is this the darkness of the tomb or of the womb? There comes a point when the darkness grows luminous. For in the words of Richard Rohr, no one oversees their own demise willingly, even when it is the false self that is dying. God has to undo our illusions secretly. There comes a time when the concepts of God that have become little gods loosen their grip, and it dawns upon the soul that God is beyond all understanding. A time when, freed from the frameworks we had imposed, we awaken to a deeper experience of the divine. There emerges an inexhaustible word beyond words. There is a time, according to James Finley, when we utter in wonder, look what love has done to me. There's nothing left here but God's love. For we cannot fully experience salvation until we gasp with need. We cannot know liberation until we face our captivity. These words from the Apostle Paul that nothing can separate us from the love of God are just nice words until we have truly groveled in the obliterated place. Such is the paradox of God's grace. The greater our need, the more exquisite the song of love. The louder the jangling dissonance, the softer the peace. The deeper the desolation, the higher the mountaintop of consolation in God's healing love. The Apostle Paul's certainty that faith was devotion to the laws of purity was toppled for him on the road to Damascus, his purpose disintegrated. His dark night of the soul rendered him unable to see or to eat, so he had to rely on the guidance of others and the initiative of the Holy Spirit. When Paul emerged from the cocoon of Saul, when he launched a ministry of planting churches and drawing together Jews and Gentiles as one body, when he relinquished the comforts of home and security only to be shipwrecked at sea, imprisoned and maligned, he dictated these words to the church at Rome. What then are we to say about these things? God is for us, who is against us? Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors, for I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. I am a lover of words, written and spoken, a lover of stories, an eager conversationalist when it comes to matters of the spirit. Yet in the second half of my life, I believe I will lean more earnestly into silence. Words are symbols, fantastical or mundane, yet in the presence of God, they do ultimately fail. A kind of quietude is what I wish will descend. Whole slices of days when I do not operate under the illusion that what I say about God bears any resemblance to the one we call love. I wish to lose my way, this time in bliss, to release the superstructure of my carefully constructed theology enough to be astonished into awe, alive to gratitude, enfolded in luminous darkness. To return to the womb of God, perhaps to be born again. I wish to see Jesus everywhere I look and hear the echo of his risen voice saying, don't hold on to me. I must return to love. I go to prepare a place for you. For St. John of the Cross, the dark night was a love story, full of the joy of seeking God. A love story of a darkness more enchanting than the dawn, a night in which the only light burns in the heart. It is the love story of resting, laying down our weary, overthinking minds, ceasing our endless chatter so that we can be held by love alone.
God promises this love is always with us, even when we cannot see it. We are never apart from it. It attends us even now. May you breathe in this luminous darkness, this love story, and give thanks. Amen. What a blessing that was. Thank you so much to the choir. One of the things that I love about First Church is the strength of the partnerships that we have with local organizations, but national organizations as well. Today, I wanted to lift up the good work that Gail has done as our representative to Washington Interfaith Network, known as WIN. WIN has a significant virtual public action today with mayoral candidates and other elected officials. We join our voices to win for affordable housing because when we organize and come together, it builds power. So if you have the opportunity to sign in today, that's at 3 o'clock, again, at virtual, you don't have to stay the whole time. But the strength of our numbers is noted by these mayoral candidates and elected officials as we continue the significant work of advocating for affordable and other justice-minded priorities. All of that is made possible by you, by your generosity, your gifts, your pledging. And so invite us now into a time of the giving of our tithes and offerings. The easiest way to do that, if you are joining us virtually, is through our website, where you can give through Venmo or PayPal. You are always welcome to mail a check into the church. And if you are worshiping with us here, there's an offering plate on your way out in which you can put your offering as well as your Easter flower order form. Now, friends, let us receive the doxology. Please rise in body or in spirit. We've come to the time in our service where we share in the prayers of the people, go to God in prayer together, and close today with a prayer from St. Francis, so we all get to speak those beautiful words that the choir sang. I would invite us to begin, and I'm going to invite Polly, if she would, to come forward and use the handheld mic for any joys or concerns that folks here in the sanctuary wish to lift up. Nora. Oh, sorry, go ahead, Sandy.
I just wanted to lift up a prayer as the United States Senate begins to its confirmation hearings of Judge Ketanji Brown Jackson. Pray for wisdom and discernment and guidance and the strength to resist partisanship for the common good.
Thank you.
Hi, this is Nora. Prayers for my uncle David, who is in somewhat of a decline health-wise. He's 94 and he's having some serious problems, and we're trying to help. So if you can give him your prayers, thank you.
We certainly will, Nora, thank you.
I want to give thanks for some very gifted doctors that Dale and I both are very fortunate to have. And particularly, I want to lift up Dr. Chen.
Thank you, Meg. What a blessing. Thank you, Polly. Let me share those that have come in to me. We lift prayers of comfort for Karen Tramontano, who is with us today, for her family after her Aunt Virginia died on Thursday. This was her father's last living sibling, and so we pray for him and for her Aunt Virginia's daughter. Jessica Prentice asks us to lift up prayers of healing for Antonio, who tore his ACL and had surgery on Thursday. Let us continue to hold up Antonio. And Chris Byrne lifts up prayers of joy that his sister Abigail gave birth to her first child on Monday. His name is Thomas. We celebrate with Chris and Karen and Peter, all of them traveling to New Orleans to visit. Welcome to the world, Thomas, beloved child of God. We're so grateful. Friends, we lift up Volodymyr Zelensky and the people of Ukraine, refugees, the internally displaced, and those on the front lines. We lift up the people of Hong Kong as they experience a dangerous COVID outbreak. We pray for families with LGBTQ children and youth in states like Texas, Florida, and South Dakota, that children created in God's image would know their sacred worth, and parents and school officials would courageously stand for justice. Prayers of peace for HBCUs experiencing a continuing cascade of bomb threats, including Howard University. Friends, let us pray. Ageless God, Ancient of Days, we come to you humbled by the many ways you make yourself known in our joys and our tears. We pray for all who are suffering in our lives and around the world, especially those in places of conflict and violence. We lift up those we love, families grieving loss, those recovering from surgery, any who are sick or struggling with addiction, those who remain in the silence of our hearts. We pray for our city and region, for teachers and students, for the impending confirmation hearings of Judge Ketanji Brown Jackson, for neighborhoods where gun violence continues, and for efforts to increase affordable housing. Even around the edges of the weighty and difficult things of this world, oh God, your hope glimmers, and your breath of life blows in like a breeze with the cherry blossoms. We thank you for forsythia yellows that make our hearts sing, for every church accompanying a refugee family here in our nation, and every family taking in another family in places around the world. We thank you for each impulse of the human heart towards the good and the hope we find in hands planting seeds in soil. For the ground damp with a little rain, we cherish every drop. We thank you that our children are together in community with the children of People's Congregational, and ask that you would bless our sibling church and their leadership. Thank you, O God, for your love, which never leaves us orphaned. May we be enlivened by your breath of life so that we might be refreshed in your spirit. Together, we now join our voices to pray the prayer of Saint Francis. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. O divine master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen. Friends, I now invite you to rise in body or in spirit and join us singing congregationally our closing hymn, O Love That Will Not Let Me Go.
Thank you.
You may be seated. Before our final blessing, I want to remind you to check our newsletter website and Facebook page for announcements. If you are a new guest worshiping with us today on Zoom, I invite you to complete the visitor's information form. That link can be found in the worship folder. If you're a new guest here in the sanctuary, please feel free to fill out a blue card. Mike has those there at the back and we'll connect you on the way out. I want to thank Tom Sowers on sound, our Zoom moderator, Alexander, the First Church Choir under the direction of Polly Gordon, and our musician Dennis Turner for making today's service possible. Thank you. After worship, we invite you to join our Nurture program, reporting on our year-long racial justice audit. That program will begin on this same Zoom link about 5 minutes after the end of worship. And if you are joining us here, it will take place right here in the sanctuary. So feel free to go use the restroom, refresh yourself, and then come back for that program. All are welcome to attend. Friends, next week, we are blessed to welcome our member in discernment, Linnea Morris, to serve as our preacher. She's here today. We will also enjoy our second week of in-person Sunday school for our children and youth. I don't want you to miss it. And now for our blessing. As you leave this space, may your mouth speak of God's goodness. May your feet walk toward justice. May your heart trust its worth. And may the breath of life fill you to overflowing until God's promised day. Go in peace. Amen.